What's up, y'all? How y'all doing today? I'm working on ground texture depth today. It's going to be algorithm-y programming. So here's what the ground texture looked like before. Had a real flat feeling for me, almost like a freaking 60s movie set. That's what I felt like Songbringer kind of looked like. So now here's what it's starting to look like. It's got more depth. The water is deeper. And the ground texture actually has a slope that moves upward from the water. You can see some numbers here. So right here at the edge of the shore, it's 0. Going downwards into the water, it becomes -1, -2. And then moving upwards away from the water as the slope increases, it goes to like 1s and 2s and 3s. And then at a little more of a meta level, as it moves upward through the overworld, it keeps on going. So it's like 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. By the time you're at the top and in the mountains of the overworld, it's like in the hundreds and stuff. So, and then it takes those, you know, 100 numbers, whatever, and averages them down so that they're like a nice slope for that given area. So I'm working on the algorithm today because there's a few problems. As you can see in this screenshot right here, down here in this section and stuff, you can see some angles shooting off to like at these diagonals. You can see it pretty well in this one place. Thanks, Galaxy 5000 and Dieharders. Let's go to that area. It's this area with rock face, and it's got some deep looking water, but it's got this jutting out of, there's another problem with the old algorithm too. There's this hole of water right there. Oh, this is with the, okay, let's save here. Let me show you with the old algorithm. What's up, Salad? How you doing today, Salad? I'm doing good, man. Thanks, Metrius. I got this really cool Salad. I got this cool new thing with Vim where I can go to all the changes I've made, all my Git changes. So it's great. I can go previous, the next change, previous change. And it's even based on the buffers I have open. So if I close a buffer, it's not going to use that one in its list or whatever. So that's kind of cool. Yeah, it's a plugin called Vim Git Gutter. Because I was always struggling with like, okay, go back is cool. You can jump to the last position you're at. I can go to the last file I was at. Or not the last file, but I can just cycle through my buffers or whatever. But it's so much handier to be like, I want to go to the last edit. All the edit points. So handy. Okay, so yeah, this is it right here. This is the last, this should be angles all. This is how the algorithm was before. And it'll create this jutting out of the shore when it comes to an angle. So long story short, that's what I'm working on today is the algorithm behind, there it is right here. So if I go on, I walk on the water here, this is the little jut I'm talking about. This looks weird. So lots of problems with the old algorithm. This is basically the old algorithm right here. It loops over tiles and gets their depths and then sets their Zs. Thanks, Super Positive and Wolfrog. Yeah, I know, right? I find that I frequently work that way where I make like 3 or 4 little changes in 3 or 4 different files. And then I'm like, wait, where was that last change again? And I have to switch context in my brain and go, okay, what file was that? Oh, it was area patterns. So I go to area patterns and I go back to that thing. Or I have to think of it a different way, like, oh, what function was that? And I go jump to the function and then jump to the place in the function where that was, blah, blah, blah. It takes forever. It's so nice to just jump to the last change. Okay, so the way this new algorithm is going to work is it's going to work in a totally different way than this thing does. This getDepth function Actually, he says like a spiraling out type thing. Like it starts with a water position or a shore position. It's like, okay, there's zero. And then if it was trying to get this tile right here, it would look, let me get the cursor where I can, here we go. So if we were trying to do this tile, what the hell is going on here? Trying to do that tile. The old algorithm works by stepping here and going, is it water? Okay, it's deeper. Here, it's not water. Deeper, deeper, deeper. Okay, then the next iteration, it goes there, there, there. And that's when it decides, oh, I am 2 from the shore. So there's a lot of problems with that algorithm because it has to be run for every single tile. If it's right here, it has to go, how about there? How about there? That's empty. How about there? How about there? Then it goes, how about there? 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 How about that? Until finally it's like the iteration of this loop is like it's gone through 60 different tries or whatever just to find its distance from the shore. So very inefficient algorithm and totally open for making a really rad change. And also it's going to change the world loading speed. Right now it's taking 840 milliseconds to load the world. That's double what it was last week just to be able to do this different ground texture stuff. So that's today's goal is to make this ground texture algorithm better. What's up, HD? It's hanging really well, man. How are you, man? Okay, the first thing I want to do before I do any changes is I want to take this and make the overall brightness a little bit brighter for the grass. So here's how it was before. Looks kind of flat, but nice brightness levels actually. Add in this texturing. The texturing looks cool, but the overall brightness has suffered a little bit. So I'm going to brighten it up a tiny bit. Cool, good to hear. I think that's as simple as just changing the world data. So it's filling with the color 0.5. Let's fill with 0.6. That might be too much. I don't need to be. I'm really excited to be going to GDC next week and demoing the game at a bunch of different events. I'm going to be at the Mix and another. Oh, I'm going to be at the Loft. Really excited. Yeah, hopefully it turns out a little better. Yeah, GDC, yep. Yep. Yeah, I'm so excited. I've never, I've demoed the game tons before. I've gone out, shown my game, brought my TV, brought my laptop and controllers and headphones and tried to do my own little events and stuff at like, not do my own event, but you know what I mean? Have a booth. But like, this is great because, Double 11 is helping out with all this and they're not like getting me into sweet parties and like, helping me out with booths. A talk on Songbringer's development? Sure. Yeah, I'd love to do that. Yeah, you should come. If you can make it out to GDC, it's actually a very cool week in the city. You know, it's like, it's game developers everywhere. And you see them on it's so great because I see game developers like even on the BART, like on our metro system. You know, or buses and things like that. I'm like, whoa, that's another game developer. And we're all going to the same place. And you get to the city around Moscone Center and it's just game developers everywhere. It's pretty cool. You can meet some sweet people there. And I'm sure opportunities abound for finding work and all sorts of awesomeness. And it's fun. It's actually really fun too. lots of parties at night. Yeah, getting game dev tips. Totally. Okay, so that was too bright. Bethesda's iterative development strategy, huh? Cool. How was it? I watched a pretty cool thing on YouTube this morning about dang it, what the hell is it? No. Forget it. Anyways, it was a cool video. I'll share it when I remember it. What's up, Arcane? How you doing, man? What's the gist of their strategy then? So that 0.55, let's see how good that was. Okay, there's before. Oh, it's a little too bright still. Okay. The gist is that they go through developing every part of the game in successive passes. So you spend a week working on that part 4 months in a row. Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, totally. Totally. I totally understand that approach. That's kind of the approach I take too. I think of it like spiraling. I think of it like spiral game development. Like you start off in the middle and then you work, and like every time you hit this line over here, you're working on code. Every time you hit this line over here, you're working on art. And every time you hit this line, you're working on music. And like you spiral like this, you're working on code, art, music, code, art, music, code, art, music. And eventually your game gets really big and looks great. because of all the drawings. Okay, a little less. That was Phil 0.55. 6.0 was way too much. Maybe 5.3-ish. Okay, there's before. Uh-huh, teamwork. Oh, I'm sure that's great, yeah, for a team. Yeah, you wrote your diploma thesis? You started it? Nice, man. Good. Way to make some progress. Before, after, before, after. It's still a little too bright. Actually, it's kind of nice. Okay, let's try 5.2. Maybe even 5.1. Here's where it was before. Oh, yeah, it's definitely better than it was before. It was a little too dark before. Gosh, 5-2 is a big difference. Jeez. Here, this is 0.52. This one was 0.53, right? I don't know. Let's just delete that one. Oh, yeah. Wow. Whoa, what a thesis, man. Man, even 5.1? Such a slight difference makes all the difference with this texture. Wait a minute. Oh, it's the wrong time. Oh, I got the wrong time. Wonder it looks so much different. Make that 65, start of the day, or middle of the day. Jeez. Okay, 65.51. Is that all it needed was the 0.51? So crazy. Let's see this back at 0.50. I'm flabbergasted. I feel like something maybe changed since last night. Point 50. Oh yeah, it does make a slight difference. It's actually nice. Yeah, if you're gonna darken everything a little bit, you might as well lighten the grass a little bit too. So either 0.51 or 0.52 is good here. I'm gonna get a shot of 0.52 again. Okay, so compared to the original. Yeah, that looks really good. It's actually even a tad brighter overall, it seems. But really nice texturing going on down here in this part. You can see some great texturing on the ground as it moves towards the shore. You can see a little texturing right here in this little divot. Okay, so next is to start working on the algorithm for it all to make it better. So these edges are going to be look a little smoother. Okay, so here's where it does this algorithm, the old one. Now I want to do a new kind of algorithm. Okay, I want to show the Z numbers. This is going to work best if I go over to this area. This is like perfect for this. Because this area has the jutting out bit right there. If I turn off this, we'll have no more water depth and no more ground depth. Yeah, okay, we got all zeros again. Okay, so time to start making this algorithm better. I want to, first of all, identify what is a shore. Maybe I'll keep this old, actually, yeah, I'll do an if def real quick. So I can have both, can quickly switch between. Call this k new depth. Whoops. This way I can easily A, B, go back and forth between these two different depth calculations and see which one's looking better. So I'm gonna start with what identifying what is a shore and then working from there. So we'll go const bool is shore. If it's a shore, if it's or maybe it's shallow. Oh, what happened to that one with the numbers? Oh, dang, I lost it. But anyways, I think the water is zero. Let's find out. Yeah, right. Okay, so the shallow water is this is what I'm talking about, the zero, the shore. So a shore is if this tile is water and the surrounding tile, any surrounding tile, is not water. Why isn't this working? Maybe because I'm in an if. So area pause X, Y, R, angle flags. Radius 1. So looking around this tile at a radius of 1, angles right. What was that last param? Oh, tiles. Okay, I'm going to start with just identifying those tiles. So I'll set these to like everything else to negative one. Oh, it's because I undefined that. I'm like, why isn't that working? There we go. Nice. That was weird. I'm like, why isn't my autocomplete? Where did it go? So if it's shore, we're going to be zero. Otherwise, everything else is a negative one. Let's just see if that worked. Identifying which tiles are shores. Right, okay, so we got zeros there. This is looking good. Let's turn up the brightness on this, though. There we go. That looks great. We've identified what's ashore. Okay, now I'm going to work in a loop of loops. The outer loop is which angle it's heading off at, and the inner loop is just a loop that goes over all tiles along that angle. So I think I'm going to start with for each compister so that I can include. Then for in I equals zero, I is less than, we need to go pretty far. So let's do the width minus times 4 thing plus plus I. So now if the we need like the directions vector. Oh, and for now I'm gonna skip the diagonals. Yeah, I just want to skip diagonals for the moment. Now, okay, to run along this directions, this line, we need we'll make a DX and a DY, I guess. DX is 0, DY is 0. Add compass dir D to DX DY. Let's check that function. Right, so if it's south, it's minus Y minus minus X plus plus. That's perfect. Okay, good. Now we've got the compass direction. And the opposite would be so this loop we're going to work away from the shore, so we need to determine if blocks is area pause x minus dx and y minus dy. K tiles, water depth. So we need to make sure that we have a one of these tiles. We need to have a short, we need to have like a We need to have a ground tile. We're starting here on the water tile, but to move in this direction, we need to ensure that we have a ground tile just to the left of this tile. So that's what I'm doing there. Your blocks is area pause at a water depth. Cool. Okay, so this is where we're gonna cast a line. Heading in this direction. Okay, as long as this current tile is, if we're going to break if the current tile is no longer water. X plus dx times I. Oh, I need to be starting in 1. And y plus dy times I. So if that doesn't succeed, we break. Otherwise, we set blocks, set z. Area pause. I guess we should do an XXYY here. Yeah. Okay, and xx is going to be the x plus blah, blah, blah. All right, now set xx, yy. The z is I, or negative I. Okay, but we also want to break if blocks get z for area pause xx, yy is already... greater than or equal to our intended z. We also want to break. That would be zero. Hold on, that would be zero. Gotta get a drink of water. So the first time we go through the algorithm, let's say we're doing this run. This is going to be 0. This one's going to be negative 1. This one's going to be negative 2. This one's going to be negative 3. But if we were coming from the other angle, coming back through this, and we were counting down from negative 1 way over here, negative 2, negative 3. As soon as we encountered something, yeah, lighter than us, or just 0. 0 can always be... no, we don't want to reset 0. It's like maybe I should actually take all the water and make it all really, really deep first. Because if I start off the algorithm and everything is already 0, it's not going to put any of this down. Hold on. What if it's just, we just allow it if it's 0? Right, this is supposed to be not equal to 0. Okay, let's give this a shot. See what happens. It's weird. Kind of did the opposite of what I thought it would. Oh, this is supposed to be not. Work away from the shore. So we need to make sure that our back, the tile behind us, is not water. Oh, I messed everything up. I left this in too. It's weird. We got like a negative 10 in the middle of all that. I don't know how that happened. Negative 23? What? Where did this negative 23 come from? And that negative 10? What's up, Regothian? Asserts, huh? I don't know if asserts are the right way to go here. With the way Songbringer engine works, assert kills it. Debugging it would help to step through it a little bit. Yeah, I could do that here in a second. I've just initially written this algorithm. I'd like to kind of like play with it a little bit first, and then debug it. See, why is this becoming negative 14? That's what I'm wondering. This one's negative 1. This one's negative 3. That's weird. Okay, I want to see it cast. I want to see it cast its lines or whatever in only one direction. Let's just do south at first. And it really should be stopping if it doesn't hit water. I want to make sure that bit's working. Oh, there. Check it out. It worked pretty well. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so if I start throwing in some other directions. In fact, how does this look with the rest of the world? Oh, see, this is a pretty good example right here. North. It does negative 3, negative 4, 0. God, that's kind of cool, though. And actually, let's take a look at how much it's improved loading speed. It hasn't improved loading speed that much. What? Wait, what if I don't even do this? What if this is not even... So now it's back to its old loading speed, 475. Wow, so this it really is. Oh, it's doing this is short calculation for things that are even not even. Oh, hold on. If area pause dot z not equal to zero, we can continue this loop. We don't want to do this. Conti. Conti. Good. Let's see if that improves the loading speed. Yeah, 512, nice. To definitely improve, but it hasn't improved it enough. There's got to be something I could do to improve the speed there. But I shouldn't be optimizing things when I'm trying to write. Gotta save optimizing for later. Okay, so good. Oh, I mean, it is casting a long ways here, but it should be stopping itself. Okay, so I move this little bit of the algorithm out. I think that'll help the rest of the directions work. I kind of like how it's not even doing south, though, but what if we just do south and east? Let's see how those two blend together. Oh. What? Oh. See, it's not blending them correctly. This is where we start to have problems. I really like how it just blends northward or southwards, though, because it really helps the depth of the game's perspective in the water. It's really cool. But when we blend in east, things start getting weird. Like down here, we've got this negative 15. Okay, so it is time to start debugging. Actually, we'll take a screenshot before I start debugging. See how these two blend together. They should be, one should be stopping the other. It should never overwrite a negative 15. Like a negative 15 should never override. Wait, we should be going, hold on, when we go to that tile comes first. Oh, wait, no. It just doesn't set anything. Okay, let's step through this. Okay, I know. I'm pretty sure that as it casts us, and which one comes first? Guess we'll set a breakpoint. Find out. This is area 000. Makes sense. X is 11, Y is 10, so it's right in the middle of the screen. Oh, this is that little, I think that's a little dip in the middle of the screen on this one. And we're heading south, yeah. Okay, I wanna see the algorithm from only from this screen. Okay, so I can work with something I'm familiar with. I'm just gonna go to this area and look at its algorithm. It's probably already like drawn some Z's. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, I think I know what's happening. Did I not take a screenshot of this? Oh, I need a screenshot of this. Obviously an eastward cast because that's what we did, right? East? Yeah. There's a big clue right here that it's got negative 15 there. So I'm thinking maybe it stopped the algorithm because it gosh, I really just want to look at that tile. Let's do that. All right, this is tile 01. I hope this is right. This would be 10. Right there, it should be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, great. Okay, so this is 2, 3, 4, 5. This is 5, 2. And x equals 5. And y equals 2. Never hit. Oh, what did I, what? It didn't hit that breakpoint? Oh, I guess that would make sense. Okay. That's a big clue. So it's not hitting that. It's not even hitting that right there. It should be at this point as it works southward. Oh, and the first water should be zero, not negative one. So I should start at zero, and this should be I plus one. Okay, so it wasn't even hitting that, which means that it, as it started going southward, oh, that's a good thing. I'll look at its algorithm for as it moves southward from this tile right here. So if x equals 5, doesn't matter what y is, as we're working away from the shore and the direction is south. Let's look at that part of the algorithm. Okay, good. We got a breakpoint. We're moving south. Why is D an int? Oh, D shadows a local variable? Oh. This should help a little. Oh, we never even checked is shore. Oh, is that what it is? Did this whole algorithm without the very first most important part? What's up, Pith? Licks. All right, I bid you adieu as well. See each knee. Good luck with the daily grind tomorrow, man. Okay. Oh man, I can't believe I just made. That's a funny ass mistake. No wonder the algorithm was taking so much time, too. If, yeah, not as sure. Continue. God, really? Okay, we got some more weirdness. Let's just try the south, see if that's the most important part is working. Yeah, that looks good. Except The zeros. Never mind. Yeah, I don't want these. There's two zeros in a row. The shore is supposed to be zero, then it's supposed to be negative one. Life's great, man. Aw, don't be sorry. What you been busy with? Yeah, life's great here, man. I'm excited to say that Songbringer is coming out this summer. That's when the release date's gonna be, and it's coming to PlayStation 4 and Xbox. So maybe that was supposed to be one. You're moving state? Wow, dude, that's big news. Why the move? That's much better. We're getting a nice amount of depth there. Wait, the other one kind of looks better though. Okay, some more. We have to call this one. That one was called today, so we'll call this one tomorrow. This is tomorrow.psd. Okay, so I can track the changes here. So now we're going to add in the eastward movement, and it's going to mess up, but we'll figure out why. I kind of liked it better the other way. But I'll save this last little touch for later as I can make the two zeros or whatever. Let's put that back in. Nice, best. Oh, your family? Oh, you're moving back home? Sweet. Oh, I like Melbourne. Melbourne's a great place. So is home like Adelaide, Perth, Sydney, Cairns, Darwin? Gold Coast. Oh, right on. Nice. Family back home, huh? Cool. Okay, so next I gotta work on this, make this algorithm. What, how does it get the negative 13s and 12s right there? I don't even know. I'll be right back. Curious. Yeah, that is a lot more efficient already. Still not as fast as the old algorithm, but we are covering. Wait, no, it's not covering. Huh, it's not that fast yet. Anyways, can't focus on that right now. I gotta get it to work first. So let's look at the one little problem area. Yeah, I have. Love Australia. When I was younger, I wrote a video game and found a publisher and published it and stuff like that. So I was able to travel a little bit and I went to Australia and New Zealand for a couple months. It was great. So great. Taught me so much. It taught me so much about the world beyond the United States, the world beyond the little town I was from in Oregon, you know? It's probably one of the best experiences of my whole life, just going traveling that first time, opening my eyes and being like, wow, this is what the world is really like. I kind of felt like it was more important than going to college. I really feel like more people from the United States should travel more often, or that it should just be more important in our culture for people to travel. Right now in the United States, it's like traveling is not really encouraged as much as going to college is and getting yourself a nice job. You know, I wish it would just be more important as for our culture for people to travel. This is an excellent place to check just right there at 2-2. So we're gonna look at X2 as it's moving south. Yeah, it is. It's a sweet country. Ayers Rock. I went to, what's that? Kakadu. Kakadu is so sweet up in Darwin. Yeah. Whoa, you're younger than 20? Congratulations. You got your whole life ahead of you. That's so great. It's so exciting. Here's another weird one. How is it getting -7 there? Okay, we'll start with this. We'll start with this -13. You're 17, dude, that's great. Wow. Okay, x equals 2, direction is south. What? Yeah, x is 2, 2. Good. Okay, let's find out why we got a negative 15 and it's not being overwritten. If this isn't water, break. Oh, what's xx? xx is 2, yy is 1. Oh, is it? Oh! Okay, let's see what's going on. xx is 2. YY is only 1. It skipped over negative 13. It's like, Okay, so it does need to work with I equals 0 for sure. Or does it? Oh, wait, maybe. Hold on. What if we start with 1, but it sets the initial. After Songbringer's out, could I do tutorials on Cocos 2DX? I'm sorry, but I probably won't be. My days of making tutorials for Cocos 2DX are done. It's because I mean I hope that what I put out there is helpful, you know, already. I already wrote several books on Cocos 2DX and released several game kits and things like that. So the problem is if I write tutorials, they take up all my time. It takes a lot of effort to make those. And so I wouldn't be making games anymore. Right? I won't be making Songbringer 2. I wouldn't be making Songbringer 3 or whatever else creations I'd love to make. That's what I really want to do is make games, man. Not make tutorials. I'm passionate about that because I've spent way too many years of my life like not doing the thing that I would prefer to do, that I would love to do. I love making games. And making tutorials was always that safe bet, you know, like, oh, I would love to make video games, but it's a safe bet for me to go make tutorials about making video games where I can make money that way. Because it's not a safe bet to make my own video game because it's a risk, right? I gotta like put all my time and energy into making a video game, and what if people don't like it? What if people don't buy it? And that's happened several times in my life where I just completely flopped and failed. But now things are finally starting to gel, things are starting to work, right? So hopefully I never ever have to make a tutorial again. Because it's not what my heart really wants to do. It's not who I am. Sorry, I get really passionate about that question. Yeah. And I guess by me trying to share my passion there, it's that I want other people to also be really honest with themselves about what they really want to do. You know, what is it that you really want to do? What's the thing that's a risk for you, right? What's the thing that's not a safe bet for you, but you really want to do it anyways? You know, what is that thing in your life? What is that thing that you're like, I'd love to do that, but I'm just a little bit scared. I'm a little bit afraid that this might happen. Or it's a much safer bet for me to do this, you know? What are those safe bets for you? And is it possible for you to do what you really want to do instead of that safe bet? They do. Ray Wenderlich has tons of great tutorials, and there already are Coco's 2DX tutorials on Ray Wenderlich's site. Check it out. There's a ton of them. See, check it out. Here's a whole tag about it. Here's a tutorial for beginners, tile map tutorial. Check it out. No song for your dance party, Jim's dance party. They are. All of Ray Wenderlich's tutorials are really great, and he's got tons of different writers. So, okay, we definitely need to start with I equals 1, but the first tile needs to get set to 0. So if this is a shore tile, it needs to always be set to 0 before we do any of this. Oh, whoops. What? Oh, Songbringer's already running. Like, why isn't it working? All right, now the shores look better, but it's still got a problem with the algorithm. Okay, and this is where I'm focusing on now. It's negative 15. It should be going negative 1, then it's like, hey, I'm gonna put a negative 2 here, negative 3, but obviously something's wrong. Okay, so that is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, once again, this is 5, 2. That should be 10. So that's 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah. All right. Set a breakpoint there. X equals 2. Actually, X equals 5. What software? I use Xcode for compiling and all that on Mac. On Windows, I use Visual Studio. And on Unix, I use, or Linux, I use GCC. I'm using a language called C++. Okay, so we've already set XY is currently 5, 4. Is it an easy language? Not the easiest of languages, but it is the most portable and one of the fastest languages out there, but especially the most portable. C and C++ can be compiled and run on just about any platform, and that's not true for languages like C Sharp, Objective C, Swift, blah, 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 Java, even. All those languages I just mentioned, you can't compile them on everything. Like a PlayStation, for example. You want to go put your game on a PlayStation, you only have like a couple language choices that you could use. And then the language choices are different for Xbox. And then the language choices are different when you compile your game for Android. And then the language choices are different for everything else. So the only like common denominator is C and C++, really. It also depends on what platforms you want to put your game out on. You know what I mean? If you only want to put your game out for, I don't know, the web, then you're definitely going to want to use, not C++. If you want to put your game out only on one platform, you're like, I really only want to put it on Windows, then you got tons of choices for languages. But I want to make a game that's very cross-platform, and so that's why I chose C++. Largely. That is a good way to describe it. C++ tries to solve everybody's problems, So that's why it's so huge. It's got so much stuff in it because it's like just kind of bloated at this point. Yeah, totally. You're not going to use all of C++'s features because, like I said, it solves everybody's problems from a lot of different angles. There's like so many ways to do things sometimes. Nice, man. Got I1, XX is 0. Oh, right. XX is 5'3". So we went from 5'4 to 5'3". So we started at 5'4". 3, 2, 1, 0. Went down to 5, 3. Good. We should get a -1 here. Our z is -1. Good. Oh, it breaks already. Why does it break at -1? Yeah, Vita. Vita, I don't know if Vita still has problems with C Sharp, but Vita also has problems. I know it was for a while Vita was like a you couldn't do C Sharp on it. Okay, so it breaks. The algorithm is I is 1. We're trying to set a -1. It's already got a -1. That's why it breaks. Oh, and it already got a -1 because it already did this east tile. So we're starting here now. It already did this one and did na 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 and went all the way across, or as far as it could that way. But nothing ever touched this tile here, this negative 15. Because we didn't go, nothing is, so I guess we have to keep going with this tile. Yeah, that's, I would say that's true. Yeah, if you fully learn one programming language, you can definitely learn others easier. Oh, it has? Oh, that's good. Yeah. Okay, so let's open up this algorithm and let it keep going. So if z equals 0, and z is less than negative I, then we can set. What language did you learn as a programmer at the beginning? It's a good question. Sometimes it kind of depends on. Oops, this is z equals 0. Or. It kind of depends on I would take a look at a couple languages first. If you're looking at what language should I learn to make, you know, to program in at first, try like two languages. I would at least try C a little bit. That's the one I would recommend if possible, is to learn C. But if C isn't your flavor, then maybe Python is a good choice. Like Python is a simpler kind of version than C, and it runs and interprets it, so you don't have to compile. There's a lot of simplicity added to Python that's really nice. Yeah, it would. Lisp, yeah, you're still having your trouble, what? What's up, Rand Dance Run? Dude, Lisp was your first language? That's crazy. C# is another great choice, definitely. C# or Java. Java is another big one these days. They're great choices. C# and Java are a little higher level than C++ in the sense that they're a little easier to use. I don't know. Actually, I'm kind of talking out my ass there because I really don't know C# or Java that well. Yes, exactly. Salad brings a really great point here. That's also why I suggest C, is because you're going to learn about memory and pointers. And the most important thing, it's some of the most important things in programming is like memory and pointers. Lua is another one kind of like Python. In that it's, yeah, that's a good choice too if you're just a beginner and you kind of want to get the hang of programming languages. But there's some real gotchas in Lua that I don't know. I don't know about learning Lua as a first language because it kind of has a few like special cases that are, quite frankly, asinine. Yeah, right, yeah, me too. The second I finally realized what a pointer was, I'm like, I get it. I get C. Yeah, this is why I don't recommend Lua. It's the idiosyncrasies and like the quirks. It's like it tries to hold to these ideals, Lua does, and it just like, let me program, let me code. Don't force me to code in an ideal way. Like, for example, it doesn't let you like break out of loops. It doesn't let you, or is it break or continue? One of the things that's like a simple thing you should almost have in every language, it doesn't let you do that because it thinks you should do it in a different way, which is kind of refreshing in the sense that it's not the whole C++ paradigm where C++ is trying to solve all your problems in every kind of way. Lua, like, forces you to do it in a certain way, which is, I don't know, I don't recommend it because it's like, you don't want to learn to do, you don't want to learn to code Lua's way and then switch to another language later and go, oh, but Lua worked that way. Yeah, me too. Me too. I really haven't used Python that much. Wait, did that work? Oh, check it. It worked. That looks great. No way. This is awesome. Yeah. Oh. Oh. And it's kind of neat. I like how, I like this southward. It's only drawing the depths going southward. So it makes for these really nice deep parts right here. And here and here. That's cool. And there. Kind of gives you the feeling and perspective of the game. Yeah. Oh, really? I didn't know that there was a big difference between 2 and 3 for Python. Huh. Okay, let's see. Oh, is that east as well? Does it throw in the east? It did. That was south and east, and it worked really well. But I think I want to do west as well. So it can cast back. Well, in fact, let's look at this. We would have to go to a different area to see the westward movement. Let's go to a different area. Oh my god, I just thought of a really important part to add to this too. The eye should never go for that long if it goes anytime it goes beyond the edge. And let me compare times here. We got world creation 508. Hey, it is getting better. But this should make it a little faster too. Oh, I'd say both. I'd definitely recommend both. You gotta look, I mean, YouTube is awesome these days for learning stuff, but I would also at least get a book. I would highly recommend getting a book and writing in it too. Like, get an actual physical book that you can write in. Or, well, you can also take notes on these ebooks these days, I guess. Really? Wow. True. This should improve the speed and without sacrificing anything. Let's make sure it still works. Yeah, it looks good. Should be exactly the same. Yeah, we're good. Good, good, good. And did that improve the speed? Oh, it took longer that time? Oh well, maybe it wasn't actually going off the edge that much then. Or maybe it actually is slower. I'm looking at X, Y. Raw clamped. So raw clamped is going to be, it grabs the very last tile. Oh yeah, that should improve the performance by checking. Yeah, good point. Good point, Salad. Okay, let's see this with West. Oh, we need an area. Area that's gonna look good with the West. Here's a really curious case. Why is it so deep right there? Oh, and also, it's not casting. It's not casting backwards there. Okay, so I'm going to focus on this a little bit. This should be a negative two right there because it should cast this way, westward from the shore. Oh, I got it. We can do a count as well. Actually, do we need a count? Maybe we'll add a count there. But let's see if this does this West thing work. Thank you. Interestingly, that did not improve. Still a negative 3 there. Definitely want to see that in action. Okay, once again, we need a breakpoint. This is area 12-0. Looking at this cast back this way, so we're at a Y of 1. Yeah, Y is 1. And the direction is west. Oh, it didn't hit that. No wonder. What language did I start with? Well, technically, I started with Quick Basic. My first language I ever was experienced a little bit with. But then my first serious language was C. When I finally started reading a book about it, things, you know, I started like learning and I started actually making a game and all that. My first language was C. And I read a book on it, which is no longer in print. Okay, what's with this here? Okay, pause 12-0. Y is 1. Let's not care about the direction. Oh, good. We are getting this breakpoint. Okay, we're at 5-1. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1. Good. So we're right there. Set to 0 for each compositor. Okay, so we work south. Now we got southwest. We skip that one. Here we go with west. Oh, I messed this up. D shifted down 1 equals 1. Oh, of course. It's mod 1 is what I meant. Dmod 2, I mean. That's a good question, Pithlix. I'm not exactly sure yet. Is it gonna come? Is it just the online store or is it the hard disk? I don't know. I will find out. Okay, that's a little better. It also fixed this shore here a little bit. And these still appear okay, except for that now. Oh, it went and overwrote that whole shore. Oh, and that's the problem we're getting right here. It's casting downwards once it gets up here. And because all these were all zeros, it's like, oh, I'm going to overwrite that, overwrite this. So, how do I fix that without making the algorithm too slow? I guess -1 should be the first number. -1 should be the first number for these water tiles, and then add 1 when we're going to get the color depth for the water. Okay, let's do it that way. Which means we need... Oh, the first one is going to be negative. So everything's going to look a little darker, but it should work now. Shouldn't overwrite anything because everything should start at -1. Yeah, I would be too. It is an indie game. It's not like a AAA game or something. Looking better, looking better. So now let's increase the when it draws the depth of those waters, should look a little brighter. Oh, that one's set to negative one though. I kind of want those to be overwritten. Yeah. Right now it's 300 megs. Yeah. By the time it's finished, it'll probably be about 500. That's mostly music. All right, when it draws, when it does set color depth in area cre oh, let's do this in Vim. So it takes 1.0 plus the depth. That's like negative one or something. I think that's what we need. Yeah, it's all that procedural audio. Everything having to be rendered 12 times makes for a lot of audio. I'd actually like for the next game to actually experiment more with generating audio. So I'll be like generating sine waves and square waves and all that, and kind of go back to a more of like a Commodore 64 style sound, but mixed with a lot of newer elements too. But I think I can make it. I can make procedural music a lot. I can focus on creating a procedural audio engine that's even better, and it allows like procedural rhythms and generates tones and things like that. It's working now. Yeah, now we got some brighter shores. It still would be neat if we allowed these negative numbers up here to go downward to, right? Like, so that would be negative two, negative three, negative four, negative four, negative five, or something. But this part's a little better. So it went negative one, two, three, and cast itself backwards that way. What are we looking at for how fast? World creation 500? That's great. Okay, we're looking all right there. Okay, so the next thing, I think I'm almost ready to check this in, but like, here's another curious part. Why didn't this one go to negative five right there? It did this backwards one first, and then it came up here and did this one, and it stopped at negative five. Let's find out. So this is x012, x2, direction south. All right. We're heading south. We're at XX25. Yeah, 25. We're looking for X2Y0. Should be put in a negative 5 there. So YY0. What is the Z already here? It's negative 6. I is already 7, though. I is already 7. Oh, because it had negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. Oh, it needs to kind of keep track of its Z better. So it goes, because this is negative 1. This should be negative 2 in this downward cast or whatever, but it's actually negative 1. It's still at the shore. So it's trying to put a negative 2 here, a negative 3 there, a negative 4, a negative 5, 6, 7. This would be negative 8 if it could be allowed to do that. So really it should keep track of its Z. So as it's going downwards, if the Z that we're currently at is greater than what we would be setting it at, then we need to set the Z to that. So it kind of tracks the Z in real time. All right, let's see that happen. The I is going to stay the same. The Z. Let's make an int. Z and ZZ. Okay, so if z is less than 0 and z is greater than zz, for example, if we're going down this line here, we start with negative 1. No, we start with negative 2. And we get a negative 1 here. So negative 1 is like, okay, great. The next thing should be negative 2. I guess this would be an else. Oh, not much. Just trying to code this algorithm, that's all. And then this would be ZZ. It's going down this line. It starts at negative 2, negative. It goes here and it's like, okay, I've got a negative 1 here. So negative 1 is less than 0 but greater than negative 2. So it sets ZZ to negative 1 at that point. And ignores setting the next block, or setting that block. Otherwise, ZZ needs to go down. Or every time ZZ needs to go down. So that would be, next time would be negative 2. What's up, professional novice? Right, so it gets here and it goes, okay, that's a negative 1. It sets its z to that, and then it subtracts 1. So the next time in the loop, it's trying at negative 2, and it's like, oh, I found another one, negative 1. Sets itself to negative 1. Subtracts 1. Now it's a negative 2 again. It goes down here, it's like, okay, it's a negative 2, but it's not less than, so... Wait a minute. This should be greater than or equal to, so it doesn't try and block set inefficiently. What's up, Zyger? You about to code for the next 5 hours, right on? How's the bug hunt? There's been lots of bugs hunted and found and solved. Right now, I'm not actually hunting bugs. I'm actually creating a new feature where the ground slopes a bit. I'm working on the ground slope for the water here, improving it so the algorithm is better, faster, and just looks better. It's going to look a lot better with the edges a little smoother. Okay, so that should work, right? So it gets to this next one. It's like negative 2. That's equal to. So it sets itself to negative 2. And the next time it's going to be negative 3. It's going to try and take a negative 3 here. But it's already got a negative 2, so it's going to be once again negative 2. And then this time it's going to be negative 3, which it already was. And then this one's going to try and set negative 4, which it already was. And so this one will be negative 5. Hopefully, this comes out as negative 5 and everything else is perfect. We'll see. Nothing almost ever works on the first try. Oh my god, it worked! Yeah! That's pretty cool. Alright, we got a negative 5 right there. So it's actually using its z values are being set over the long run or whatever. Let's see if that other how the other area is looking. So this is almost done. See how this other area is looking, and then I'll enable this to start working for not just the water, but the ground. So everything near the shore will be zero, and then as it moves away from the shore, it gets like one, two, three, and moves upward. Good, this looks beautiful right here now. So much smoother and nicer than it was. That's a negative two, negative three. Yeah, good. Got negative one, negative two. You can see before, as I started this whole journey today, that was layer four. Compared to the beginning, we've lost a little brightness. We can bring that back though. Oh, that was the beginning where I doubled up the zeros, so I could definitely double up the shore and make it nice. Harder to stay motivated in your career. Tips? Well, if it's hard for you to stay motivated, why? Why is it hard for you to stay motivated? I don't know. I don't want to guess on that because this is your life, right? What is it that's like making it hard for you to be motivated? What's the challenge? Okay, let's see if this algorithm works if we do the reverse and apply it to everything that is not water. Kind of want to check in so far, though. This is really good. It's just the cropping and that. The other jobs wear you out? Oh, right. Yeah, you use up all your energy working on these things that you don't really, they're not your dream, but you have to do them. Yeah, the rent, the bills. I know this feeling, man. I know this feeling. Gosh, I've spent a lot of years feeling the same. Well, I don't know. What if you switched it up and instead of putting it your time and energy first into your day jobs, what if you woke up a little bit earlier and put, say, even just a half an hour or an hour into your dream first, before everything else? Make your dream your highest priority, you know? Would that do it? Because then you'd start seeing some steady progress, right? And you come at this point, you come home from work and you're tired because you've already put all your time and energy into your job. What's up, PX, by the way? And then you don't have any energy to put back into your dreams. So what if you put your energy first into your dreams? Even if it's just an hour, you'll still be making steady progress, and then maybe you'll be totally more motivated and you'll make that progress, and eventually that your dream will flourish. Because without that steady daily time, you're not going to be making progress with your dreams. But if you're making progress, then maybe you'll feel more excited about your job and everything too. You'll be like, hell yeah, I just spent an hour this morning and I made progress towards my dream. Doesn't matter if it's a small amount of progress, at least you're making progress. Don't know, it's just an idea. Yeah. All right, I like this statement. I'm just gonna keep this all dirty and comment it out like that for now. Oops. Get this checked in. Okay, this is new depth algorithm version 1. All right, so now I want to apply it to not the water. Okay, so basically this bit of code is what's casting away from the shore and setting the depth of the water. I basically need to duplicate this to use to do like the next loop, but I'll want to take this whole intersection and make this a function. But before I do that perfectly the right way, I'm just going to duplicate this and do it the non-cohesive way. Just so I can see it in action, right? We know that we're working away from the shore for that. We want to work also away from the shore. And this is kind of built into the algorithm too, the direction. So if the direction is south, or east, or west, we do this water algorithm, and then the regular ground. Can have its own choice of direction. It says work away from the shore to set ground height. So looking, this is, we're going to be using plus dx. So the, Yeah, we do want to see behind. So if direction is north and behind is water, wait. Yeah. No, wait, yeah, we want to see if the tile in the direction. So for heading north, it's going to be dy is like 1. And we're checking if heading north it's not water. Yeah, that's right. All right, see you, Pitlix. The Z is going to start at 1. Oh, wait. No, oh, yeah, that's fine. Z's 1. We're going, say we're going north. Let's pretend like we're going north, like right here. We'll start there. This one will become a 1. This will become a 2, 3, 4, 5. And if it is water, we break. Z. If the Z is greater than 0 already, and the Z is less than or equal to the ZZ we're trying to set, we set our ZZ. Otherwise, we go ZZ plus plus. Okay, which makes it kind of clear why I had to like separate out these two bits of code, because they all, both have different mechanisms. I got to figure out how to, you know, get the right variables so I can do this loop as a function. But let's see if this worked. This would be great because I'm hungry. I got to take a break from streaming. Come on, work. Make some dinner. I want to do something and call it done before I'm done. Holy crap, it kind of worked. Except for casting backwards from the south. We want to do... Yeah, we just want to do all directions. It worked. Nice, there. Let's see a screenshot like that, and also a screenshot like this without the north or south direction. Oh, I'm stoked. This algorithm is faster and it works better than the other one. It doesn't create these weird little jutting angles anymore. So there's with texturing applied and everything, but the height is getting all the way to 10 right there. And then there's with the texturing applied, and it's down to 1, 2, 3 going in this direction. Which looks like this might be the finished algorithm right here. It's looking really good. Okay, everything's gonna be kind of weird with the. I'm gonna check this out, see how it looks, but I wanna go to get ground offset H, return 0. So it doesn't offset any of the stuff by its height because we're gonna go up to some crazy high heights. Right now, let's turn down the opacity. And we'll run around the overworld, see how things are looking. We should see things get really high. As you get up towards the north part of the overworld, the tile Z, the numbers on all the tiles should be really high. Like it should get up in the 70s and the 80s and stuff. So here we are at the very, we're at the bottom part of the overworld. We're at Y equals 0. As we move northwards, we should start to see higher numbers. Here we're seeing like 1 through 5. There's a 10 right there. That's kind of weird. Oh, that's because we need this direction to smooth it all out. Yeah, there we go. Now we got some nice 1 through 5s. Interestingly, these are like 13s right here. Okay, I'm seeing why, because the algorithm isn't casting diagonally. It'll need some diagonal angles too. How did these all get to be 0 though? This is super weird. Oh, I guess the algorithm stopped. Some point. The sky is all 0 here. This is so weird. Why are these all 0? I guess the algorithm stopped itself at some point. Okay, this is the big problem with this so far, is a lot of zeros. We should be seeing like numbers 70s, 60s, 30s, 40s, 50s, all those. Because we're pretty far away from water at this point. See, here's 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. But see, it's not casting in the diagonal direction. It's not creating zeros, right? That's why all these are 0. Oh, so it could be that on these screens with all the zeros. Oh no, wait. Oh, does it end at the edge of this? Wait, hold on. It might be this valid thing, this valid check. Oh yeah, we're starting to get a lot better numbers. Here's some 15s, 16s, 20s. We must be getting closer to water there. Yeah, we're seeing some water here, so that's why it casts it back. Once again, here's a diagonal one. This is a 21 right there, but that shouldn't be. It's not doing diagonals yet. This water is all 0, that's wrong. I wonder what happened there. See if we get some better numbers up this way. 1960. So we're getting some 60s right there. That's probably also due to no diagonals. But overall, this is looking a lot better. Oh, here we go. This is a good one to check out. Negative 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 20, 20. Yeah, see? That's how it gets these numbers there. But it gets all zeros there, I'm guessing, because there's no water at all for it to reference. Oh, and is this the top of the world? Oh, yeah, it's the top of the world. Okay, that's why there's no... It's like, oh, there's no water there at all. So that must mean that there was no water at all to the south of here for this whole world. See, there's some water. There's some water right here. Oh, but it's only going four screens north. So we would need to go further. Right, this would need to be width times even 8. Oh, and this really increased the algorithms working hard to do this. Yeah, we got hundreds right there. Well, that was negative 100. Yeah, so we started that screen, 14, 15, 30, 40, 70. Oh, apparently we hit some more water somewhere around there. Okay, good enough. Well, things are looking a lot better. If you look at the screenshot from the start of the day to now, here's where we were before. Here's where we are now. So we got a much nicer algorithm. It needs to be better though. Like, there's still some work to be done. What's up, Super Positive? Yo! Sorry, I'm just shutting it down now, man, but how you been? Okay, so let's get rid of all this junk. It's time for some dinner. All right. Well, I hope you've been well, man. Hope things are good with you, Super Positive. Things are great here. I'm really excited that Songbringer's coming out this summer. It's coming to PlayStation and Xbox, as well as Steam, of course. So, anyways, thanks for watching, everybody. We'll connect next time, Super Positive. We'll see y'all. Have a great one. I appreciate you all.